This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Thanks for listening to the ungated version of the Unsupervised Learning podcast. If you want to read some essays on some of these topics, please check out razib.substack.com. Again, that's razib.substack.com. Thank you.
You know that genetics plays a huge role in our health, and more people are using genetic testing to determine risk for diseases like cancer for themselves and their kids than ever before. So I want to tell you about Orchid. It's the only company that does whole genome testing for embryos, testing before your child is born. If you're doing IVF, this is a clear choice now, because now you can reduce risk for thousands of single gene disorders, including heritable forms of autism, pediatric cancers, and birth defects. Check them out at orchidhealth.com.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And today I am here with my friend, Steve Hsu, who is a professor of physics at Michigan State, and also a startup founder, entrepreneur, public intellectual. Steve's done many things. And, you know, I just say friend. Sometimes you say friends in kind of like a generic manner where it's like everyone's your friend. And, you know, I honestly, like, I am the type of person to do that. Like, I'm a friendly person. But, you know, just to be clear, Steve is a real friend. I've known him in the meat space, as we would say, in the 1990s, since 2005. We've, you know, kind of worked on projects together here and there, talked to each other. We know each other. And, you know, we're aligned in a lot of ways. So this is going to be a very collegial conversation, someone I know really well. But, you know, brilliant guy. And I think you guys will find the topics that we're going to cover interesting. We have a lot of history together. And so some of this is going to be just reviewing where we were, where we're at, where we're going. And so to start out with, you know, Steve, when I first met you, like I met you in your office, like in real life, I met you in your office at the University of Oregon in 2005. You had these small children who are not small children now. Like, lots changed in the last 19 years. I didn't have any children. Now I have children, et cetera, et cetera. My hair is gray, you know? So, but we still have a passion for the same things, I think. Well, not all the same things, but many of the same things that we had back then, you know? And so one of the things that we are passionate about, I think, is, you know, human genetics, population genetics, behavior genetics, these sorts of issues. And, you know, when we were first talking, genome-wide association was like a kind of like a little bit of a twinkle in the eye. It wasn't really happening to the level that it would like 5 years later. By 2010, it was like a big deal. 2005, it was like, HapMap had just come out. They were still doing candidate gene associations and whatnot. And so the two of us, like, we were looking at the future and we were hoping for great discoveries. And some of them happened and some of them didn't happen. Can you tell me what you are feeling didn't happen? I'm curious what you think about that. Like, what did not happen?
Yeah, but I'm really psyched to discuss this topic, but I just want to say, Razib, it has been a pleasure to know you now almost 20 years. It's hard to believe.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you had, I think you were one of the founders of something called Gene Expression, which was a blog.
Still around, the domain's still around. Yeah.
And maybe, I think, predated my having a blog, so you were an inspiration to me in that way. You're significantly younger than me, so you were a little more like internet, a little bit closer to being an internet native than me, because I was already an adult, you know, when the internet took off.
Yeah.
And I just want to say, like, you and some of the other guys, I don't know if it's public knowledge, but a certain very prominent guy we know was very big. Many prominent guys actually were participants in GNXP.
Yeah.
And I don't know if we're allowed to say that stuff, but it's
you didn't name names, so it's fine, you know.
So a lot of prominent people that you would know now and that. Anyway, so you were an inspiration to me. That was one of the first like really active intellectual communities, small intellectual is where the discourse level was very high that existed pretty much only on the internet. So that was kind of a new phenomenon for me. I mean, I had my own world of physicists and professors and
stuff. Sure.
The internet world was a new thing for me. And then meeting you in person, because you got your undergrad degree at University of Oregon, so you would pass through Eugene every now and then. getting to personally, I think you were one of the first people that I first encountered on the internet and got to know in person. There's a little cafe. I think it's called Espresso Roma. I forgot the name.
Yes.
Of it.
Yeah. No, that is Espresso Roma. Yeah, it's still there.
It's on University Avenue. Anybody who's familiar with Eugene, Oregon will know it. It's an institution at the University of Oregon campus. And you and I met there and I think we talked for hours, and the people around us were just shocked. Like, who are these nerds? Like, how can these guys talk for hours at this cafe? So anyway, I have very fond memories. It's been just great to be your friend all these years, Razib. And I just wanted to say that because, of course, like, we have a lot of friends in the world. And, you know, I'll often refer to a guest on my podcast as my friend, but very few of them have I known as long as I've known you. So I just wanted to get that out of
there. Yeah. Yeah, no, that's for real. Yeah.
Yeah. So getting back to genomics and what's happened since 2005, just to remind the listeners, at that point in time, there were only a few data sets, like 1,000 genomes was considered a lot back then. And, you know, just basic questions like, gee, I was told by my sociology professor that I have as many genes in common with a Nigerian as I have with another Chinese guy. And people really believe that. Social scientists really believe that. Some of them still believe that, actually. And when they had the first, you know, relatively small data sets with hundreds or, you know, 1,000 people, they could at least do some clustering or genetic distance comparison between groups and show, you know, very, very definitively that, oh, I have sort of 10 or 15% more genes in common with people that share my ancestry group than people that are of a distant ancestry. So lots of things got established right away that were, I think, kind of obvious if you have more of a mathematical or scientific mind, but they were very contentious. They were very contested new bits of science that came out at the beginning of this period when we just first got analysis of the first hundreds of genomes. I think now we're at a point where obviously we routinely analyze sometimes a million genomes at a time, and we're able to build pretty complicated predictors of traits, complex traits, like how tall are you? What color are your eyes? Do you have elevated breast cancer risk? Those are all things which are pretty standard now, have only really become standard in the last 5 years. You were asking me about what I'm disappointed by. I would say I'm disappointed that we didn't make more progress on cognitive ability, which is a trait that I'm particularly interested in. People often attack me for being interested in that trait. I'm not interested in that trait because I'm especially focused on group differences. That's the reason the trait is particularly contentious, because obviously we've long had these hypotheses that some groups are, quote, smarter than others. And obviously a big part of colonialism, imperialism was based on those ideas or those assumptions. I would still be just as interested in cognitive ability if there was only one ancestry group. So if the whole world had been nuked and only some Icelanders who were almost like genetically identical survived, and I was one of those Icelanders, I would still be interested in why Johnny, the Icelander kid who I'm tutoring math, is not as smart as Jane, the Icelander kid that I'm tutoring in math, because those individual differences within an ancestry group or within even a single family are super fascinating. So in other words, what is the genetic code that builds your brain, and why do some brains perhaps function better than others? That to me is the main disappointment, that we haven't been allowed to make progress on that. And I say haven't been allowed because there's been lots of money to increase sample sizes for targeting medical conditions, lots of other complex traits. But the one that you just cannot get any funding for, and in fact, you will be viciously attacked for expressing interest in, is cognitive ability. So that to me is just a very irrational, crazy view. I understand where it comes from culturally. There's a cultural war over this question of group differences. And so I understand why it is the way it is. But I think a Martian, the proverbial Martian, or Mr. Spock coming to Earth would say, why are these humans investing so much money in genotyping people, and they're not even interested in the main question, which is why their brains are so much better than all the other species on the planet?
Yeah, I was assuming that you were going to say that, and I want to get back to that. I want to take issue or just elucidate maybe one thing you said, because it's a common thing to say. the connection with these ideas of group differences and superior, inferior, and colonialism. And people often think, oh, well, you know, this is the cause or of colonialism. And what I would argue is, you know, in some cases that's obviously true. Like, let's say, like the colonial enterprise of Africa by the late 19th century. But I think that these hypotheses and these like ideologies related to these hypotheses emerged after the initial wave of colonialism. And just kind of these hierarchical structures that develop between different cultures and different nations. And so it's one of those things where the ideology was a kind of like post hoc justification or, you know, for what was already happening. And then in the later stages, there were some colonial enterprises that occurred where, okay, this ideology was rolled out as justification, but really that was like the later stage. And I think people need to understand that a lot of times our ideologies and our views emerge organically from the situation on the ground, and then that's used to justify what the situation on the ground is. It's not what actually determines the situation on the ground, right? So, for example, in the United States, yeah, go on.
I just want to say I agree with you, Razib. I mean, people were enslaving each other and stealing their territory long before there were any theories about group differences. However, maybe as a post hoc justification or something that came to mind in the among the early natural scientists upon encountering different groups of people who maybe were still using Stone Age technology, you know, it became ingrained in the many of the ideas justifying colonialism and things like that.
Yeah. And like, so let's talk about like the cognitive genomic stuff. So just so the listeners know, you are not alone in being very fascinated about this. And I'm saying this because, you know, I can see, I'll tell you guys, I can see which links you're clicking. And when I post like link roundups, you guys love that stuff. Okay. When I post a podcast with James Lee and Alex Young, you guys are really pulling that stuff down. Okay. So I know you're interested. I don't know if you want to acknowledge in public you're interested, but you are interested. You care. And so I'm sure that a lot of you are also disappointed. So right now, like, where are we at? We're at like 15%. Of the variants being explainable by genomic prediction, right? Is that correct, Steve?
Well, okay, I have to be. I mean, since you have experts watching your show, and also there are now professional computational genomicists, like professors who, you know, weigh in very heavily on this stuff. We should be very careful. There's a phenotype called educational attainment, and because that's a convenience phenotype, because in many medical studies, they will just ask the patient or whoever they're getting the data from, oh, how many years of education have you had? So there's a lot of data, millions of genomes with an attached education attainment number. It's not directly a cognitive score. It is correlated to cognitive score, but in a very complicated way. The best EA predictor probably does capture something like 15, 16% of total variants. There's a whole bunch of debate as to the nature of where that correlation comes from. Is it direct causation in those alleles affecting the formation of someone's brain? Is it stuff that actually you got from your parents and caused your parents to be better caregivers? Or
are you talking about indirect effects there?
Yeah, so it's very subtle. I just want to say that there's a lot to that EA phenotype, which I'm pretty sure it's not. Just it's not directly cognitive ability. And I'll tell you about a study that we did some years ago already. We built a cognitive predictor using UK Biobank data. There's a fluid int field in the UK Biobank data set in which they administered, I think it's 12 or 13 questions in just 3 minutes. It's a really terrible, shitty cognitive test, but it is a direct cognitive test. It's called fluid int. And it does correlate, you know, with your cognitive score. A higher fluid int score is associated with having a higher real IQ score. That there's been validation studies of the fluid int number, but it's a pretty noisy cognitive score. We built a predictor using that. And I think at the time there were maybe 150,000 of the UK Biobank people who had done the fluid int test. And we could predict fluid int better with our predictor trained only on 150,000 people, then you could predict it with the EA score, which had been trained on, you know, millions of people or some at the time. I think it was maybe a quarter million people. And When you then test those predictors, you validate them among siblings. So you restrict, we have about 20,000 siblings that we can do these tests on. So you restrict to the siblings for whom you have these scores, and you say, well, does the test still predict the difference in phenotype between two sibs as a function of difference in polygenic score? Is that prediction as good as if you just take two random people in the population and try the same calculation? It turns out the EA predictor decreases in power tremendously, whereas the fluid int predictor decreases a little bit, but not nearly as much. And the way we interpreted that, we didn't really talk about this much because this is something that we did, and it was in a huge paper where we validated lots of things using the sibling method, mostly medical traits and height. Our interpretation of that is that, you know, the deviation between like how much education brother one and brother two gets is determined by a lot of things. There's a little bit in there of like whether brother one is smarter than brother two, but or more conscientious. But a lot of times the parents are just pushing the kids to get a lot of education. And so there was a lot of loss in predictive power if you compared kids who had grown up in the same family environment. But that was much less true for the fluid int predictor. I say all that just because I want to point out that EA is not the same as cognitive ability or fluid int.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I mean, I'm not just saying it's a really good point to say it's a good point. That's an excellent point, actually. And so what I'm getting across from this, and like I actually I'm not gonna lie, I have not looked. Have there been twin studies on EA?
You mean in the sort of classical literature, like the old?
Yeah.
I think so. I think there was some prior knowledge about the heritability of EA. Now, again, the thing with EA, again, it depends a lot on, are we talking about samples from a country where college is free? Or are we talking about samples where you have to go into debt? And of course, then it makes a huge difference, right? Because the way that kids accumulate those extra years of education after high school is socially influenced. Yeah. So EA is just a very tricky trait. And my hats are off to people like James Lee and Alex who work on this. I was kind of a doubter. I was like, always like, I mean, we all go back a long time in this field, right? So I used to joke with James and the other EA folks, SSGAC, and I'm like, this is such a crappy phenotype. What are you guys wasting your time on? Let's just wait until we get more real cognitive scores. That was kind of my attitude. But they were right that you could still get a lot from just using this convenience phenotype. But they have to do, and if you look at the supplements, the appendices of their papers, they have to do tremendous analyses to normalize the EA phenotype across countries, across decades, across social economic status brackets. It's an insane amount of analysis that actually makes the whole thing a little bit like rickety to me. Like I just wouldn't put that much store in their thing. I would rather wait until we accumulate a million or more cognitive scores.
Yeah, so let's go through a few issues that you just kind of like implicitly brought up, and I'll flesh it out for the listener. So you're talking about cognitive scores. There's obviously, you know, we're talking IQ here. So IQ is not, I mean, IQ is the general factor, of course, a bunch of, you know, the general intelligence factor. A lot of listeners will know what that is. That's kind of the closest thing that we have. IQ is kind of a colloquial term. Really, we're talking about general intelligence factor, which is measuring the correlation between all the tests due to a common independent factor, which is, psychometric aptitude. IQ, like, you know, colloquially. Okay, so that exists. Obviously, something like EA is a phenotype. It's an outcome that goes through multiple sequence of, you know, variables, conditionals, et cetera, right? There's a sequence of like, you're raised in this family, you're in this country, et cetera, and so forth, in terms of what the correlation between educational attainment and this general intelligence factor is. This is the key of, like, you know, just to be explicit what we're alluding to here. There is a correlation, and the correlation could be zero or the correlation could be one. If it's one, they're just substitutable, and everything you say about EA is pretty much, you know, equivalent for this psychometric characteristic that we're really interested in. If its correlation is zero, then like, okay, like we're not getting anything out of that. It obviously is not zero. People that are more intelligent on these psychometric tests that are have a higher score, let's just say that. They have a higher score on psychometric tests are much more likely to get a PhD in physics. Okay. I think we know this intuitively. We know there's a correlation. The question is, what is the correlation? What you're talking about within family effects, that I think intuitively makes sense to a lot of people. I will tell you, just like the listener, my family is one where There is no expectation that you graduate from college. There's an assumption. Okay. <That's> like, you know what I'm saying? Undergraduate degree is the baseline. Okay. And I'm not saying to brag or anything like that. This is just the way I was raised. It was never a discussion because it was assumed that you would go to university and get your university degree and definitely not as a studies major. Okay. So there's certain cultural expectations within our family, no matter what the range in like psychometric aptitude, which within sibling cohorts, like standard deviation is what, like 12? Like it's not trivial. There are families that have, you know, okay, like kind of smart kids and extremely smart kids. Both of them are going to be pushed to go to university and get those degrees, get the 4 years of higher education. And the outcome phenotype technically may be the same for two individuals that are actually very, very different in their cognitive abilities. And everybody within the family knows that. Everybody within the family knows that there's one individual, one sibling, everything is easy, effortless, and the other individual has to grind, grind, grind to get the same output. But they do it. They do it. And that is partly due to parental expectations, assumptions. Also, can your parents help you with university, financially, all of these other variables that are going in. And so that's muddying the correlation between the psychometric ability and the output. And, you know, the outputs themselves. So the correlation, I think, what is it like correlation between SAT and grades, GPA was about 0.5. Something like that. I'm assuming that it's actually declining because of grade inflation, but I don't know. But all of these things are measuring, reflecting something underlying. And, you know, psychometric aptitude is not the only thing. You know, there's other personality traits. There's other things going on. And so, like, you know, at the extreme tails of, say, you know, like, let's talk about, like, I don't know, theoretical physicist, you know, you and even I know people that want to get PhDs in physics at Princeton. These are the creme de la creme, you know? And I don't know, like, if there's, like, a special test that they could take that would separate them. But also, like, who succeeds and who fails? Like, there's a lot of stochastic effects that are going on at that level. Equally brilliant people, one person picks a project that pans out, one person picks a project that doesn't pan out, et cetera, et cetera. And so, you know, there's a lot of path dependency there. So I don't want to like overemphasize, obviously, the cognitive ability, but it is a big deal in terms of what's going on in society. And let me just ask you, you are in the university system. They're getting rid of the GRE. They're getting rid of the SAT. I mean, look, do you sometimes feel like the crazy man in the land of the sane or the vice versa, you know, at this point?
Yes. I mean, probably maybe we're going to talk about this, but so from 2012 to 2020, I was the vice president for research at a Big Ten university. And that's a position with significant authority. I mean, I was responsible for about $700 million a year in research expenditures. And even more, perhaps unusually, I was the highest administrator in the hierarchy. I reported directly to the president of the university, who read every faculty promotion file each year. That's a little bit unusual, because the president who hired me wanted to enhance the academic reputation and capabilities of Michigan State. He made sure that all the deans knew that not only was I like the guy who was like responsible for the research funding that went to those colleges, I was also the guy who was going to sit in a little sweaty room with them every year reviewing the tenure and promotion files of the faculty. And you know me, Razib, I'm not I'm a nice guy, but I'm not going to back down from anybody.
Show me the money. I mean, not literally money, but you know.
Show me the Nature publications and the NIH grants, right? I was often in a conflict with a dean who wanted to promote some faculty member to tenure who had a weak research record, a weak overall record, but they were in a particular ancestry group or diversity category. And so I went through many years of that. And the trend really just surprised even me that we got to this point. I think it was that Summer of Floyd thing where people just went bonkers for diversity. And at that point, like, we just said, oh, every college has an internal office called the Institutional Research Office that does all these statistical calculations. How are the students doing? How are we doing on research funding? All these numbers, the kind of things that you would report to US News and stuff like this. And if those guys come in and say, hey, you know what, if we admit using SATs, there's no way we're going to hit this goal of having this number of kids from that particular ancestry group. And then the response for many years was there'd be a fight between the people who were for academic rigor and meritocracy and the people who are just for diversity. There would be a fight. Around 2020, that fight just became a knockout, where the diversity people are just like, they could point to something and say, hey, if I can argue this is bad for diversity, we're just going to get rid of it. And we're only now just starting to recover a little bit from that crazy time, this kind of Maoist time in 2020, where some schools now are starting to reinstate the SAT. Many graduate departments have gotten rid of the GRE and the GRE subject exam. I hope that comes back. I don't quite see it happening yet, but we went a little, in my mind, we went a little crazy around 2020.
Yeah. And I want to get back to that, maybe at the tail end of our conversation after we talk more about science. Let me ask you, I know we share a common interest in quantitative genomics and behavior genetics and stuff like that. Honestly, I haven't, like, probably since, I mean, I checked the EA papers, but I haven't kept track of the field too much, partly because it seems like there's a little bit of stagnation. Actually, those of you who have not read it, I'm going to give a call out to our mutual friend James Lee, who's been on the podcast several times. Steve knows him very well. And so he had a City Journal article, Eye on the News, Don't Even Go There. The National Institutes of Health now blocks access to an important database if it thinks the scientist's research may enter forbidden territory. And a lot of it has to do with disparate impact of, like, you know, basically, this is literally political correctness, filtering the scientific hypotheses and questions. I can tell you guys privately, and Steve knows this too, a lot of people are griping about this and angry, but they don't know what to do. They don't want to put a target on their back. This is, censorship. They're censoring. That's what they're doing. And so I feel like there hasn't been that much advancement in the particular trait of interest here compared to what I was hoping, expecting. And I've kind of, like, turned away my focus from that. I'm just, like, waiting for the big step forward. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, it's just fruitless to spend too much time on this particular phenotype. Everything else is advancing. So the amount of data available, if say you're interested in diabetes or interested in heart disease, the amount of data that you can use to do studies.
Or schizophrenia or autism.
Absolutely, yes. Or Alzheimer's. All those things are just growing at a steady pace. For cognitive ability, it's almost kind of not growing at all. This could change over time. I don't want to disclose too much, but people are working on this. But the time scale is quite long, and it's quite expensive, obviously, because to get a good cognitive score for an individual requires, potentially a lengthy testing procedure.
Yeah.
So it's non-trivial. But what you would like to see is a government that actually cares about, neuroscience. Gee, I guess neuroscience might be helped out if we knew the genetic basis for differences in individual ability, cognitive ability, right? Why don't we put, $500,000 behind, the assembly of a million genomes with associated cognitive scores? Like, that would be a fantastic outcome, but there's no way to get that funded in today's environment.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to happen in the United States, if I had to bet. I think our political environment is too toxic for that. We are the world's innovation center. We are the world's basic science center. So that's probably not going to happen. Certain parts of Europe are actually a little bit more chill about this. Like, the Netherlands, anyone who follows the literature knows that they have, like, a big twin registry, and they do their thing. Because of its independence, the Max Planck Centers can sometimes do things in Germany. Germany as a whole, so for the listener out there, it's probably already been published by the time that this podcast will be live. I'm writing a piece on the genetic history of Germany. Germans are not really interested in their own genetics. There's some history there. There's, like, a big gap in the heart of Europe when you're talking about, like, genetic analyses and population genetics, and I think we know why. But the Max Planck Centers are pretty independent, just like EMBL is pretty independent, And so there might be things going on there. Sweden, as most of you, well, not most of you, but a lot of you will know, Sweden has, IQ testing for conscription. I don't know if they still have conscription, but they had it for a long time. So, and those people, I think their names are recorded, like you could track them. We have the technology to do this if we wanted to. So do you choose to do it? That is the question. And what Steve is saying, and I kind of agree, is like, you know, we just choose not to look right now for various reasons. I want to say for the international listeners, because I know like sometimes you get like hyper-American, and so Steve is saying diversity and all these things. So he means a very specific thing. Diversity, equity, inclusion is really focused on race and sexuality. Does not mean diversity of thought. Does not mean diversity of religion. Generally it doesn't mean diversity of religion, but like, for example, in the United States, like, Muslims are de facto coded as brown, even though they're all different races. And so I can imagine someone saying like, oh, she has a hijab. That's like diversity because it's like racially inflected, right? So it's very, very particular, culturally specific idea of what diversity is that he's alluding to. We all understand now. So for example, I'm just going to make like a joke, but like, it's like you could have a department, and if everyone's black, it's very diverse. Okay, we're not talking Shannon's index of diversity here. You know, we're not talking about a technical. It's like this weird vibes thing. You know, and so I think it's a little infuriating. Actually, I know it's a lot infuriating for people like Steve. Me now on the outside, I just shake my head. You know, maybe raise my fist. You know, anyone who follows my Twitter feed knows that I have opinions on this sort of stuff, right? But I wanted to be clear about that. Before we move on to like some non-biological topics, Steve, I want to ask you, as you know, I have gotten really interested in ancient DNA over the last like decade or the last 15 years. So Antonio Regalado at MIT Tech Review, a friend of yours, you know, I'm not going to stipulate how friendly, but, you know, I told him in, I think in American Society of Human Genetics in 2013 or 2014, he's like, you know, what's on the horizon? And I was like, keep an eye on this guy, David Reich. There's going to be a lot of stuff that's happening in ancient DNA. And he's like, at the time he was like, oh, okay, whatever. And he didn't follow up. And like, he says that that's one of his major regrets, over the last decade in terms of not following up, because obviously he would have been ahead of the curve there. And so he always asked me like, what is happening in genetics and stuff like that. But anyway,
mind on that topic, I'll break some news for you. So, thanks partially to you and other people, I was following the ancient DNA and Neanderthal DNA stories pretty closely many years ago. And that partially led to the creation of this startup Othram. So Othram, as some listeners may know, solves crimes using forensic DNA. And I think the record is we've solved a case with only using about 15 cells equivalent of DNA. So found at a crime scene, and then we use that to get a genome for that person, say the killer, and then we're able to find through genealogical data sets, we're able to find a close relative of that killer, and then the police can catch the killer. And I think something like 1,000 cases now have been solved by Othram. But one of the things that motivated me to do the back of the envelope calculations that told me many years ago, probably 7 years ago, that this was possible as a crime solving tool, was the fact that I just said to myself, wait a minute, if we can recover Neanderthal DNA that's 50,000 years old, why can't I recover a cold case DNA from a cold case that's 50 years old or 100 years old? Yeah. And indeed, cases that old have been solved by Othram. So actually, I have you and others who are interested in thank for some of that.
So Middleman, David Middleman, CEO, the prime mover there, I guess. He's been on this podcast 3 years ago. He's a friend of mine. We're still in touch. And yeah, a lot of our conversations relating to forensic genealogy I remember talking to him. It was after the Golden State Killer thing happened. And, I had a call with David and I was like, you know, like they could do a lot of this, right? Because, if Pablo can pull out, you know, the oldest now is, I think there's something older than 400,000. There's definitely the cave in Spain is 400,000. I think there's some older ancient DNA now. They're probably going to make it to about 1 million, and that's probably with a few exceptional cases. That'll probably be the limit of DNA. Protein, they're going to go even further. So, you know, I just wanted to bring up the DNA, ancient DNA stuff because, you know, we're talking about stagnation in a field that we're interested in. And then there's like another field where it's like, literally, I don't think people could. We didn't have a human genome in the year 2000. When we first had a discussion, there was a handful of human genomes out there, I think. Literally a handful. They're in an Excel sheet, and everyone knew their names. And so now we're getting genomes. We have dozens of Neanderthal genomes. Like Neanderthals. Some of them hundreds of thousands of years old. So the rate of technological change in some areas of bioscience right now is incredible. And, you know, we have a, you know, it's just like there's this synergy between different fields. So it's like computation along with automation. And then there's also some fortuitous, you know, chemistry. So, for example, polymerase chain reaction, which I think a lot of you will know, you know, I mean, that wasn't really a thing before the mid-90s. So that's really amplified, literally, our ability to get DNA and get at DNA in things like forensics and whatnot. I want to pivot a little bit. I know that you have a new startup. You're working in a new field. It's related to artificial intelligence. And, you know, you're a physicist. So some people are probably thinking like, wait, this guy's a physicist. You're talking about like genetics, and then you're talking about artificial intelligence. Let me tell you guys, physicists, they are the imperial wizards of knowledge. They go where they choose to go, and no one will stop them. So I don't know if Steve's like got into economics too much, but that's a very common thing. They dabble in social science. Physicists are smart. They don't need you to know they're smart because they know they are smart. I've never had a physicist correct me that they had a PhD, ever. It's not needed. A credential is not needed. They open their mouths and they know, you know? And so, you know, I want to talk about artificial intelligence a little bit. I haven't dug into details like what your kind of like 50,000 foot view of this field is. I've been talking to people recently about it on this podcast. Like some listeners may be a little curious and confused because of my background as a geneticist, but you know, in technology, it's impossible to avoid the specter of artificial intelligence, of what it's going to do in terms of improving technology, existential risk, you know, all these other issues, these big picture issues that people are concerned about. How is it going to affect medicine? You know, how is it going to affect like a lot of areas of operations research and operations science, you know, in terms of like, you know, for example, like me, like you, we get a lot, you know, we both get a lot of email. You know, if we had an AI assistant, that would be like, you know, this is like, give us summaries, give us the highlights, and then we can actually like focus in on respond. So it can potentially increase productivity a lot, you know, but yeah. So, I mean, what's your general take?
So I think when a science historian looks back on, say, the last decade, one of the biggest stories will be deep neural nets. And the breakthrough that happened with large language models just in the last few years, so audience would know that as GPT, that that has really accomplished is the following. So I take a very big neural net with, you know, perhaps 100 billion connections, and I train it to predict the next word given the, you know, n preceding words. And, you know, they've effectively done this with, to first approximation, all the text ever generated by humans. Okay, a trillion words of text. And now you might say, what's the point of that, Steve? What's the big deal about being able to predict the, you know, 50th word given the 49th word in some chunk of text? If you think about what the model has to understand, what understanding has to be encoded in those neural connections for it to be able to perform that task well, what you conclude is that task forced the organization of the deep neural net to encode effectively a representation of all the concepts that humans have ever written about and the relationships between those concepts. if you're a little bit mathematically minded and you understand high dimensional vector spaces, I encourage you to go look into this, because what has happened now is that they've built a roughly 10,000 dimensional vector space, which encodes all the primitive concepts that humans use and their interrelationships. And these transformer models are basically using that. All the calculations are doing are within that embedding space. To the casual user, all what they realize is, like, I have some chatty bot now that understands what I say to it in multiple languages and can respond appropriately. So it's a huge breakthrough. And if you know the history of AI, there was this question of, like, how is the AI ever going to know that when I say, how much is that doggy in the window? The only way the model can properly understand what that means, if they know that there are things called pet stores, and that oftentimes there's a little pet for sale in the window, and how much refers to the cost. And the reason the doggy is in the window is not because it's someone's home, but because they're at a mall and it's a pet store, right? So there's all this, like, implicit knowledge and understanding and relationships between concepts that most AI people until just recently despaired of ever, quote, teaching their AI all this stuff. And in just one jump, by basically brute force training on huge data sets and using the right clever architecture for the deep neural net, they basically surmounted that problem. So that now these GPT models have an internal representation of basically all the concepts that humans use. So that's the way I describe the breakthrough. Now, the problem with this breakthrough, and the reason we started our company, superfocus.ai, is that this technique, you will have noticed, it changes the neural connections in such a way that the model does well if it properly guesses the nth word or n plus one word. And when you say it did it well, it's comparing against some training samples where those n words appear. So it's really being trained to generate plausible text, but not necessarily factually correct text. So if you ask the model, is there a United Airlines flight that lands in Paris tonight around 6 p.m.? It has seen many references in literature to that kind of thing. And it'll say, it could easily just say, yes, there is. There are first class seats available, you know, or whatever. It'll say something which is plausible. It's similar to the text it's seen. But in fact, there may not be United Airlines flight landing at 6 p.m. in Paris. So that's called the hallucination or confabulation problem that models have. And it's really a fundamental consequence of the way that they train these models, okay? So to solve the hallucination problem, our startup built something which conceptually we describe as an attached memory. So when I talk to you, Razib, you're using the language and reasoning center in your brain, which is very similar to what a GPT is, what a transformer model is, but you're consulting your memory. So if I say, hey, Razib, remember when we first met? The part of your brain that interprets that sentence is different from the part of the brain where it's pulling out, like, oh yeah, espresso aroma. Steve talked for a long time. I couldn't believe how much espresso that guy can drink, right? That's being pulled from somewhere else and shown to the language center, reasoning center of your brain, and then you formulate your response. So we've built a software architecture that allows our customer, which could be, for example, a consumer electronics company, they can take the training manuals that they use to train their call center people. Troubleshoot your smart TV for you. They tell you where to send it if it's broken. They do all these things, right? The manuals that they use, we can install now as the memory that the LLM accesses. And the LLM will then faithfully answer any question that the human asks using only the knowledge that's in the attached memory and not the training samples that it saw relevant to TVs and stuff like this. So instead of telling you that there's some drop-down menu that you need to access and click button 4, which doesn't actually exist, that's a common problem for LLMs, like, you know, being asked these kinds of troubleshooting questions, it will only respond based on what is in the attached memory, the ground truth that we and our customer have installed. So you were asking about jobs and how this is going to impact a human society and whether you're going to have a personal assistant that sends email for you that's an AI. All those things are possible once the hallucination problem has been solved, and it is now reliably solved. So, for example, this consumer electronics example that I gave you, the technology actually is deployed and it is superhuman. So it does a better job troubleshooting problems with these smart TVs than the modal human call center worker. So it's superhuman, and it's actually rapidly, in the next couple of years, going to replace a lot of human jobs. My co-founder and I, Tushar Sheth and I, have been tag teaming, flying back and forth to the Philippines and Singapore, because a lot of this call center work is done by people in the Philippines who speak English well, but the wages are quite low. And over the last 20 years, a lot of work has been outsourced to the Philippines, to the point where 8% of the Philippine GDP, $40 billion a year, is exactly the call center work that I'm describing. But that can now largely be done by the kinds of AIs that we build. The kind of AI that we build could actually read through your email messages and formulate responses, sticking very closely to what is in the message that you received, and then some base information that you wanted to rely on in answering those, like about your podcast or the state of your startup or whatever. You can tell it like, hey, only respond using these 100 pages of information that I gave you. Don't deviate from that, but respond to whatever the person asked for. We can easily build AIs like that now. So I think the impact on human jobs is going to be significant over time. And I think it's something that people really actually don't understand yet. People, even economists and such, have not really figured out how this is all going to play out.
Yeah, there's so many ways I can go with this. As we're recording, stuff is coming out with the 1 minute videos produced by OpenAI that are very realistic, except for like some weird feed things. I do have to say, as you were talking, you were using N words. Maybe you should like change that phrasing a little bit. I know what you're trying to say. Yes. So, but in any case, I think, a lot of stuff you're saying is fascinating. It's clearly going to transform the way we work in a lot of ways. I don't know, like, how accurately GDP is going to be captured. I've seen arguments. I don't know what you said that, like, what you believe, but that the internet has transformed our lives in ways that have had economic effects, but it's not captured by GDP. I think that's probably true. I think AI, OpenAI, ChatGPT and stuff, that's also going to be similar. I was just curious what Gemini, I have Gemini Pro, and ChatGPT thinks of you. Gemini didn't say much. It's pretty generic. And there's also a cardiologist named Steve Hsu, but I'm going to read what OpenAI says, and I'm going to ask you what you think about it. Not that long. Steve Hsu is a physicist and entrepreneur known for his work in theoretical physics, genomics, and higher education administration. He has a diverse set of interests and achievements, including contributions to the field of quantum information theory and the foundations of quantum mechanics. Hsu has also been involved in the application of advanced statistical and computational techniques to understand the genetic basis of human traits, including intelligence. He co-founded a genetic testing company which focuses on deep genetic information for various applications, including personalized medicine and understanding human evolution and diversity. Additionally, Hsu has had academic appointments, including serving as professor of theoretical physics and at times taking on administrative roles within higher education institutions. Hsu is also known for his involvement in discussions and debates surrounding genetics, intelligence, and their ethical implications. He maintains a blog and podcast where he discusses these topics, among others, related to science, technology, and society. It's worth noting that Hsu's work, particularly in areas of genetics and intelligence, has been subject to public debate and controversy. Critics have raised ethical concerns about the implications of genetic research on intelligence and the potential misuse of such information. So, I mean, that was pretty good. There's some weird issues in there, but
I think that was really good. I don't have any complaints about that. That's much better than The Guardian would.
What did The Guardian say?
Oh, well, so as your listeners may know, our company Genomic Prediction, which does embryo genetic screening. The Guardian has, I think, written several articles attacking us over that kind of thing, as you know, it's eugenics, it's evil, et cetera, et cetera. So, also they don't like, this is in the weeds, but The Guardian really doesn't like me because I'm friends with Dominic Cummings.
Oh yeah. You're a Dominic Cummings stan. You're public about that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's weird. Just so the people out there know, once you have hit pieces written on you, it kind of exposes. All of a sudden, you're focused on what the structural parameters of journalism are, what the motivations are. So you find that a lot of it is like personal beefs. Like, why are people that are just like you not attacked? Well, the personal beefs are not aligned. You know, it's not like totally random. Like, there are reasons behind it. You know, when I still have the recording, I should post it. It's legal. With the guy that wrote the hit piece on me in Undark, like, there was like a moment in our multiple hour conversation where he almost apologized for what he was about to do, because Deborah Bloom, the editor, clearly had told him what he was going to write in terms of, like, you know, it's not going to be like, you know. And so he didn't use very many quotes from me because, like, he didn't get too many bad quotes from me, you know. So I never cooperate with journalists, by the way, if there's any journalist listening, unless I know you really well. I never cooperate. I will never give you a quote. I will ignore you. I will block you. And then also, if I do trust you and you do turn on me, I will destroy you. Just to be clear, I will come after you personally on social media and with every person that I know. So come at me. I will come back at you. I've been canceled so many times, it doesn't matter. You can't kill the dead. Sorry, that was kind of a dark segue, but, like, I'm serious about this.
I'm glad you have that perspective. I think if more people had that perspective, I think that a lot of these journalists are just irresponsible. This is a long digression, but I think that the standards of quality and truthfulness in journalism obviously are pathetic these days. So, yeah, I agree with you.
Well, so in terms of AI, we are obviously in a hype cycle right now. You're doing a startup. You're being an entrepreneur, and actually, just random. It's a small world. you employ a guy who is, like, I got to know recently, very young man in Austin, and then, you know, he's like, oh, my boss is coming into town. And I'm like, oh, who's that? And I'm like, oh, I've known him. Anyway, everyone out there, there are 1,000 interesting people in the world, you know. And that's it. That's what I've learned in my, you know, into my early middle age. That's what I'm going to say.
Yeah, it is kind of a small world of, you know, if you put various cuts, like, this person is, you know, pretty intelligent. This person is willing to do original things, even if they're against the grain. This person has the determination and willpower to carry through a lengthy project that might last years. You're already down to a fairly small number of people. And when I meet a young person that I think could be in that category, I am very interested to get to know them and understand what the world looks like to them. So it's just a treat. I'm in the Bay Area right now, and we just had a meetup dinner. Actually, the guy that you mentioned, I believe, has since moved from Austin to Hayes Valley, yes, which is sometimes called Bayes Valley, because all the AI guys are here. That's where I'm staying right now. And he was at dinner last night. We had this whole meetup of people last night. So yeah, it's a great time to be alive. Like, just to come back to the AI thing, there's this hype cycle where, like, when ChatGPT launched, people were blown away. And then you immediately had people talking about doomer stuff like singularity and Terminators killing us. But if you listen carefully to what enterprise CEOs said, CEOs of big companies that might use this AI, you just listen to their quarterly call all throughout 2023. They were always saying, we can't deploy these things at enterprise level because they hallucinate. We can't take the risk that it gives wrong information to one of our customers or books a flight that doesn't exist. You know, all these things are the problem. So in the background of this hype bubble, you have companies, like, in the trenches grinding, trying to fix all these problems. And so my own plug for our startup is that we actually have fixed these problems. We have AIs deployed now that do not hallucinate and are superhuman in their capabilities. So you're just going to see more and more of that. You're going to start to see less and less of statements by enterprise CEOs, big company CEOs, about hallucination, because their people are gradually going to propagate up to them. Yeah, it's solved. We have an AI that basically handles, like, the equivalent of the FedEx communication about packages and stuff like that. We've actually built one that's in testing right now. So you're going to see these AIs deployed at scale, and they're going to become an everyday part of your life, the way the internet has become, very big part of it.
Yeah, I will say, for example, I would love, I think a lot of people would love an AI that would, do Excel work for them, right? The issue is, like, you are not going, I mean, especially, like, all of these, like, you know, McKinsey Excel, you know, jocks, like, they would never trust an AI to do the Excel work, because, like, hallucination could be a massive, massive financial hit. They're going to get, you know, they're obviously not going to have a career after that, whatever. Okay, so I get that. But I was also, like, talking to, so I mean, I might have him on the podcast at some point. My friend Nick Gray, he does these like, you know, he's an exited founder and he does these little cocktail parties where people meet new people and everything like that. And I think like when it comes to something like party planning, hallucination is not actually necessarily a bad thing, because what it does is it introduces some wild cards, and otherwise everything is over optimized. When it comes to, so my theory of like, I'll put my theory out there, because like, as you know, Steve, I am a very social person. You know, my theory is like basically like I have a core group of friends, and then periodically like I'll sample out, you know. Now that's an opportunity cost. That's time. I'm not going to get into that, but until recently, I didn't have very much time. So it was a very big opportunity cost, but I would still do it because 1 out of 10 times I meet someone really cool and then they're going to be one of my new friends. Otherwise, you know, friends move away, et cetera, et cetera. You're just like pool kind of like over time declines, you know, and that's just how it is. And, you know, a lot of people, I don't talk about my personal life too much, but there's a lot of people that say things online like, men don't meet new friends after college and all that stuff. You know me, Steve. That's not a problem for me. You know? Yeah. It's just like, we just put ourselves out there and we're like, hey, what's up? Like, are you interesting? Are you not interesting? If you're not, you move on. You know, maybe you're interested in someone else. This isn't rocket science. It's not physics, you know? So I think like a lot of these interpersonal things, AI could help. I'm not introverted, but I think introverted people would be able to actually benefit from some of these nudging technologies. I don't know how they could get rid of their social anxiety. Like maybe they need some sorts of pharmaceuticals. I don't know. I don't want everybody in the world not to be introverted, though. That's another issue when it, you know, this kind of looms over our, like, you know, embryo screening and other questions. You know, I call it the Korea problem. In Korea, South Korea, everyone wants their kid to be a doctor, or lawyer. But most Koreans are stupid. Because most humans are stupid, you know? So that's not going to happen. I'm being very, like, blunt, like an East Asian mom right now. But, you know, most Koreans are wasting their time trying to be a doctor and lawyer. So you have a nation where people have, like, all of this, like, investment in education. But their outputs are not commensurate, you know, in terms of how much effort they put in. And I've talked to many Korean people of, like, midwit level, who are clearly extremely resentful about all the effort that they put into education, because they're managing a hotel now. They have a middle class life. They're happy. They're fine. But like they have like a really weird, freaked out attitude towards learning. I mean, I it's hard to describe because I didn't go through that. And they still revere learning in a way, like they know it's super important. But they're obviously going through PTSD. That's what's happening when I talk to them. When I talk to them about their kid going to college or something like that, they're having PTSD. I only bring that up because, you know, if everyone embryo screens for like extremely tall, good looking, intelligent, whatever, however you define it, if it's like total homogeneity, you know, I mean, United States, like, and we've talked about this, Steve, United States is an extremely wealthy, productive country, but like on the metrics, like, you know, IQ is not as high as Taiwan or South Korea. Like, what's going on? Like, we have, like, this unique mix of... We were talking about diversity earlier, right? Like, we do have diversity. It's not optimal in some ways, okay? Like, the crime, other things. Everyone knows that. But, like, look at the innovation centers that we have, you know? We have San Francisco. That's all. That's all that's needed.
Yeah, U.S. is a special case because, first of all, U.S. absorbs a lot of the top brain power from the rest of the world. Up until recently, we had by far the best educational institutions in the world. And so people would come here and then the top people would stay here. So we're in a unique situation. Also, you know, as you know, in the post-war era, we were the only undestroyed industrial economy in the world. So the game was here. The infrastructure was built here. The great institutions, the great laboratories, particle accelerators, all that stuff is here, supercomputers. So, but less and less so over time. So if you actually ask, like, with 4 times the population and slightly higher, at least by test scores, cognitive ability in China, if you put some cut, like someone who's able to, you know, do an advanced degree in engineering or physics or something, how many people did they have in the, you know, in the generation that's just entering the workforce? It's almost an order of magnitude higher than the United States. So, and those people are no longer required to come to the U.S. They can work at the cyclotron in Beijing. They can work at the battery research, you know, company in Shenzhen. So everything is shifting. So this idea that the US can have like a lot of people that can barely read and write, but still be the richest country in the world, that will be challenged over time. I think that model is going to be challenged. And but looking backwards, yes, it's worked great for us so far.
So, you know, Steve, I want to talk about higher education and, you know, go into like what happened to you a little bit, at least in terms of what you're comfortable with. But I want to talk about like China also really quickly. I am like much more bearish on China than I was 3 years ago, partly just because like bizarre governance and whatnot. Obviously, like the human capital stuff that you said is totally true, you know, but it seems like it flourishes a lot more when it's in the United States. Okay. In terms of like what can come out of it, like in China, you could create a unicorn and then the party decides not a good sector, done. Okay. So I think like this sort of like instability is a major problem. And the second issue I have to say is like, we've been looking for innovation centers outside of the few that exist in the United States for a long time. Don't look to Europe. Everyone knows this. I have a lot of European entrepreneur friends. There's a reason they're fleeing. Okay, Europe is where civilization is going to retire. As far as Asia, you know, there always has been an issue in a lot of East Asian societies in particular, because when we say Asia, that's what we're really talking about. I don't want to talk about the permanent Raj, okay? Just I don't want to talk about that, okay? But like in Japan, the hierarchical system in science, some of that also is true in like other parts of East Asia, and that's obviously dampening innovation. I still think China is going to be great, obviously, when it comes to engineering. And gaining efficiencies on a lot of the processes. But in terms of like basic breakthroughs, I'm still now more bullish on the United States, partly just because we have a crazy, chaotic, not over-engineered social system. So that's what I'm going to put out there.
Yeah, you may be right. You may be that it may be the case that the East Asians are a little bit better at optimizing stuff than, you know, zero to one completely novel new ideas. I think it remains to be seen, because that civilization, you know, despite any headwinds coming from Xi, over a longer time scale, they're getting richer, better educated, and in a sense, I think they will eventually become more free. So I think it just remains to be seen what will happen. I will say, I often say this when I'm interviewed on podcasts, if you really want to know what's happening in the world, you should just write down on a sheet of paper 10 key areas, industries, or technologies that you think are important, and then spend 20 minutes on each of them seeing what is actually going on in China. Oh, is solar energy important? What are they doing in China? Well, I guess they dominate the industry. Okay. Energy storage, electric vehicles, batteries, that could be important in the future. How's China doing on that? Oh, I guess they're dominating that industry. You know, AI, that seems pretty important. How's China doing? Oh, actually, they have a number of models that are comparable, maybe a little bit behind GPT-4. But you know, you just go down the list. Space exploration. Oh, I guess they have their own space station and they've landed, you know, rovers on Mars on the far side of the moon. I guess I didn't know that. It wasn't really reported much in the U.S. media. You know, if you actually just go down the list. Oh, jet engines. Oh, shouldn't they have good jet? Oh, I see. Now they no longer require Russian or American jet engines. Their J-20 stealth fighter has a domestically produced jet engine. You know, you just go down the list and you realize, wait, something is happening here that you could lose track of if you're not paying attention.
No, that point is taken. And also, like, you know, I'll just like explicitly, you know, people like, you know, there's some skepticism of Chinese science sometimes for various reasons. Some of them are not unfounded. But I do know for a fact that so in an area that a friend of mine works in, and I'm just going to say what it is because I'm not outing his name. There's many people work in this area. Agricultural genetics, applied agricultural molecular genetics. And you know, the guy knows the area and he's like, yeah, they're catching up and surpassing. It's hard for American institutions now to get postdocs, Chinese postdocs. It's hard to get them. And if they get their PhDs, they leave. They don't stay in the United States. This is very different from 10 years ago. So that's just fundamental reality. So we got to keep that out.
Fast economic growth rate in 10 years, your country could easily become twice as wealthy as it was. So like, rules of thumb that applied 10, 15, 20 years ago for US-China relationship or how attractive it is for a highly trained scientist to be there instead of here, all of that can change, you know, over a period of time where, oh, they became 4x richer, you know, than they were before. So everything is going to be a little bit different. You have to actually watch the frontier in China because it's moving so fast.
Well, I do have to say, this is the last word before, because like, I know you got to go, and I want to talk about the Michigan State issue. But I will say, not everyone is as fecund in East Asia as you, Steve, so that's another major headwind. High IQ, but they're going to disappear, bro.
That's probably their biggest challenge. They have to solve that. But they have about 20 years to solve it. So the people that are going to enter the labor market in China over the next 20, 25 years, they're born already. We know the numbers. And they will continue to have a deepening of their human capital pool, not in raw numbers, but in terms of the level of number of trained engineers, number of trained scientists, number of MBAs. That will continue to grow, actually, over the next 20 years. So people who
try to do
demographic forecasting of China are usually like innumerate people. Well, if you do it carefully, you actually see very different things, at least for the next 20 years, than what most of the people are predicting.
Okay, so I want to like end on, we've been having a good collegial conversation. Obviously, we're friends. And it's not like a pleasant topic, but I want to like touch on what happened to you in 2020. I was emailing you then. A lot of people were chatting about it. Like you got like famous. Some of the people that went after you were, people I've been friendly with, like people I knew personally, like people who our kids have socialized together. I'm not as close to a lot of those. Mostly they're not as close to me. Let's be candid. A lot of the people in academia that I used to be close to, that I used to came up with because, they decided in 2020 that they were going to take a stand for anti-racism by canceling people like us because, we're white supremacists. I don't know. I'm just saying, it's just like the whole thing like doesn't make sense outside of an American context. People are really confused. I did have some non-American.
You're the brownest white supremacist I ever seen.
There's a reason that the KKK, they have those hoods, okay? Just saying. but if you're like anyone, I mean, I had a friend who supported Elizabeth Warren and he was being attacked as right wing in his lab.
Yeah.
Cause like he wasn't a Bernie bro at the time. So I mean, this is what was going on in academia. Some of the people that were observing what happened to you were not surprised. And you were kind of surprised, right? But actually, like, let's just give us capsule summary, and then tell us your perspective on what happened.
Let me give you a summary because most people are not aware, even if they followed superficially what was on the internet or in the media about what happened to me, they don't know the whole story. So I'll just go into it a little bit. There are two forces that were trying to get rid of me. One was a bunch of radical leftist grad students from the union, the GEU, Graduate Employees Union, and actually led by a guy, I won't say his name because I'm much more gentlemanly than him, but you know him. He works actually in genomics and got his Ph.D. at MSU, and he was basically the ringleader of this whole thing and basically trying to create a kind of Twitter mob to go after me. The second thing, which is invisible to people who are outside the academy, is that if you work as 8 years as the hard-ass guy who is trying to impose rigorous standards and grow the university research budget, you make a lot of enemies. Anybody who is the chair of a department or dean of a college that isn't getting the money from me because I'm putting it into, STEM stuff, is going to be my enemy. Anybody that I've clashed with because they wanted to promote a professor who had never gotten a research grant and not published very many papers simply because that person was, quote, diverse, we would clash over that because, frankly, that is illegal. A lot of illegal things are done in the name of diversity, okay, just to be totally honest. So because this is not affirmative action admitting a freshman to your school. This is a legal employment matter where you are perhaps denying tenure to an Asian research professor, assistant professor, and you're giving it to an assistant professor from some other ancestry group, and the disparity between their track records as professors is enormous. This would happen routinely. It is happening routinely at every university right now. And I was fighting against that, so I had a lot of enemies. Okay, so that's the backstory. The grad students, rather comically, link to a bunch of blog posts I had made over the years and claim that this showed I was a racist. But if you read those blog posts, most of those blog posts are me discussing a published scientific paper, not by me, but maybe by David Reich. Okay. So that these comical guys who couldn't, I think their reading comprehension isn't very good. They would often characterize, or maybe they did it deliberately. Maybe that's more charitable. Either they're liars or they're dumb. They would mischaracterize some blog posts that I made as a racist thing. But of course, people never go and bother to read the actual blog post. They would just assert something, right? So anyway, that was a campaign that was going on. And they started a petition to get me fired from my position as the vice president for research. And meanwhile, the people that were my enemies within the MSU system obviously were very happy to sign on to these petitions. Then there was a counter petition. The counter petition, if you look at, if you're a credentialist and you say, well, what's the level of prestige of the pro-Steve petition? Wow, Steve Pinker sent a letter to the president of the university supporting me. Sam Altman signed my petition. The former dean of Harvard Medical School signed my petition. All kinds of, so the level, huge numbers of STEM faculty at Michigan State signed my petition. So anyway, that's where it was left. Now, the guy who was my boss, who was not the president who hired me, she had since been replaced, he was not nearly as committed to the things that she hired me to do. He was scared. He was literally scared. I can say this because I had many conversations with him about what was happening in the wake of George Floyd in that summer of 2020. He was scared. All corporate leaders, all higher ed leaders were scared that they could easily be overturned by this wave of craziness that was sweeping the country. And so actually he said, well, I'm going to ask you to resign. And, you know, the way that position works, vice president for research, I report to the president and I'm basically the instrument of the president, you know, to do the things on campus related to research and academic integrity, stuff like this. And if he doesn't want me working for him, I have better things to do in life. So I just said, if you want me to resign, I'm going to resign because I'm not going to work for you if you're swayed by what these idiots are saying. So that's how it transpired. And actually, I'm quite happy. Like when I look back, I can't believe I actually did that job. Like, why was I working so hard to save these, you know, corrupt, horrible institutions that our universities have become? Like, why should I be doing that? Let other people do that. I've got better things to do, right? So that's the capsule story of it.
Well, you know, I know, Steve, you have often said that, and other people have said this. You know, I have friends. I want to say this because I think people don't understand that. Don't understand who you are sometimes or who you were, where you come from. I remember talking to you, I think in Berkeley, we had coffee 2008. And I mean, everyone out there, just so you guys know, I've never been a lib. I've never been liberal. I've never been on that side. Steve, you were in exultation about Obama and stuff. I was like, okay,
This is a funny thing. Like, because of the weird woke thing that happened, many university professors like myself who voted for Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, John Kerry, Al Gore, you know, suddenly we're right wingers. This is how insane it is. If the average American could understand how far left our professoriate, our grad students have become, they would just be shocked. It's totally at variance to the standard distribution of political views in this country. Because to normalize the country as a whole, I'm a liberal. I'm left of center. It's just insane. But on campus, I'm a right-wing nut compared to the
Benito Mussolini.
Yeah, I'm Mussolini compared to the woke sentiment on campus. But how can we allow our institutions of higher education to be that far at variance to the beliefs of the people in the country? There is something wrong here. And what has happened is that the university shifted so far to the left that now it becomes an uncomfortable environment for the engineering professor who's a Republican. In fact, they even feel justified in not offering the job to the young applicant as assistant professor if that person is a Republican. It's revealed he's a Republican, or even worse, like he thought about voting for Trump or something like that. The whole thing is just in a runaway nonlinear feedback loop where it's just getting worse and worse and worse. And smart, talented young people can figure this out and say, like, hey, man, after I get out of grad school, I'm going right to Silicon Valley and start a company. I'm not going to be within this crazy circus that the university has become. So that's unfortunately the situation we're in. But even like Republican state legislators and congressmen don't really understand this. DeSantis understands this a little bit, actually, but he's done a lot of things in Florida to try to correct the situation. But most, even Republicans, I think Republicans are a sorry lot, actually, honestly. They just don't seem to be very effective in the world. But they don't really understand like how far things have changed and that they need to reach in and correct these things before it's too late.
Yeah, I 100% agree. I've talked to people. They're clueless. They think, well, they don't want, you know, I've talked to people where, you know, an aide, I'm not going to say who, he was an aide to a prominent Republican senator. And I was just trying to like kind of get across like shit's going down, you know, and he said, well, you know, a lot of the Republican senators don't want people thinking that they're Neanderthals. And I'm just like, it doesn't matter. They're going to put them in cages. You know, it's like, doesn't matter what they think. So, you know, you've said, Steve, to people before, that academia, you know, you wish there was a place as intellectually vibrant, you know, academia, people are just really interested in these deep questions and there's no other place like that. Would you still say that in 2023, 2024?
Well, unfortunately, it's still largely true because professors are paid to think and explore issues in great depth over many years. And there aren't that many other positions in society which allow you to do that. You know, there are the national labs. There are some new alternative universities like the University of Austin, which I'm involved with a little bit, which are trying to create more based institutions of deep thought in higher education. But it's a heavy lift. It's going to be a difficult road for those new institutions.
Yeah, I mean, I guess like, you know, it's the issue is like, you know, what is the net good of because, you know, there were always communists in academia, though Americans were not communists. It was understood that that was the cost for this, you know, vibrant institution that produced all these ideas and spin out.
If you watch Oppenheimer or whatever during the Cold War, there were some communists at the universities. But now a lot of those beliefs, which were only held by those communists in those earlier times, have become the standard woke beliefs on campus. That's the shift that really shocked me. You know, that people can openly say, like, dude, if there are too many South Asians and Chinese guys in our department, we're going to discriminate in hiring against the next candidates that come through that are from that ancestry group. Like, where did that come from? That's I call that racism, right? But this is actually practiced. No matter what these guys will tell you, if they're on the record that they don't do it, they do it, and they think it's okay. And they're basically judging people by groups. So it's okay to discriminate against the Chinese or Indian researcher who's trying to get tenure in favor of a guy who's Black or Hispanic. They think it's okay. They think that is justice. That is the woke mentality. Yeah. But I call that racism. I cannot believe that people accept this, but it goes on every day at our university.
Oh yeah. Quite literally, you know, people tell me what happens in searches and the conversations that happen. And there is a university that you are very familiar with, that you may be affiliated with, in a department that you're familiar with, that may have hired someone based on their race and gender. Just speculatively.
I'm sure they have. I'm sure they have. The part that's really verboten to say is that this has been happening for a longer period of time in certain hard sciences in favor of women. So it's also true that, you know, again, very noble goal. We would like to have more representation of women in physics and math, engineering. Let's hire more of them. But if you actually look at it from a legal perspective, it's actually legal what they're doing. They're discriminating on the basis of sex.
Yeah. So I'll give a concrete example for the listeners out there, because this was told to me by a department chair in mathematics at a Research One university, not a top 10 in math, but not like bottom tier. So let's say like mid-level. And this guy, he's a man. You know, conventional liberal, not quite woke, but not anti-woke, definitely. And he said, basically, on the faculty searches for math at his university, and I wanted to stipulate the prestige level just so it's like, it's not Harvard, but it's not, you know, I don't know, like bumfuck state. Okay? It's you know. In any case, this individual said, usually the top female applicant, and they have to hire a certain number of you know, women, the top female applicant is ranked 50th out of the total pool. Okay? That's what he said. And this is not, again, this is a pretty liberal guy, actually. That's what he said. So there you go.
Yeah. So this kind of thing is going on. The rest of society is not aware of it. These institutions are still in part funded by our tax dollars. And they play an outsized role in shaping the worldview of students who go there to, quote, get educated. And so it is important that when the variance becomes so large between the belief system that our institutions of higher ed adopt and the general population, something has to be done. It is not right for, you know, what would be considered a centrist political position to be considered grounds for disqualification in hiring for a faculty position at a major university. But that is roughly the situation now.
Well, okay, so we've been talking for a while. I know you got to go. I want to close out this discussion particularly. You know, I hear a lot of things privately from people just because I'm a big mouth and I will tell people what I really think. So they know that they can be safe talking to me, that I won't denounce them. Anyway, what have you heard that surprised you or shocked you or just like has like, you know, taken you aback or just like it's been sobering since what happened to you? Because you became, I mean, you were already out there, but like, you know, for like a hot minute there, you were the main attraction in the academic circus, you know? So what did you hear? Like, just give us, obviously, like no names needed, but I just want to get a general sense of what you heard, like what you were exposed to after that.
Oh, I'm not sure exactly what you're looking for in this question, but you know, I'm sure there are people that still hold a grudge against me and that you know, they would try to block me if I applied for a certain grant or did something. So there's probably a lot of that like now that they know who I am, they're probably going to go after me. On the other hand, you know, there are plenty of people that support my position. There were actually many people who emailed me and said, "I support you, but I'm not going to sign your petition because I'm afraid." Is that the kind of institution that you want, you know, your kids to be educated in? So, you know, I'm not sure exactly where you're going with the question.
No, that's what I was wondering. Yeah.
Just to show you, so in Michigan, like in California, we have a state law that was passed by referendum against affirmative action. But I know for a fact Michigan State and Michigan were practicing affirmative action against, in violation of state law, for many years during the time that I was actually in office. Do the Republicans in the state of Michigan, even the ones who got that law passed in the first place, care or know about this? No, basically not. So the whole system is pretty malfunctioning right now.
Yeah. Okay. One thing that I'm going to say here, I was talking to a friend of mine. You know, you're talking about like people who are scared. Academics, you know, generally cowards. You guys can disagree, but I know you're a pussy and you won't say it to my face.
Oh, I totally agree. I totally agree with you, Razib. Most people in academia are careerists, and they just want to get ahead. The best thing that I could say for the majority of them that lack courage, the best thing I could say for them is they would say the following: "Oh, I support you, Steve. But, you know, my main goal is to push forward our understanding of dark energy in the universe. And I can't jeopardize my big NSF grant by supporting you publicly, but I do support you." And okay, that person at least has an articulated justification for the cowardly behavior. Fine, I respect that. I maybe would not have been a hero during the Holocaust. I maybe would not have, you know, risked my own life and my family to rescue people persecuted at that time. Most of the people in academia aren't even thinking like that. They're just like, go with the flow conformists who, you know, they don't have an original thought, you know, in their heads, which is kind of surprising because they are supposed to be the leader, intellectual leaders and researchers in this country. But that's after a very long career in academia, I would tell you that's an accurate characterization.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, you know, not just in academia, tell me like, you know, they're based and all this stuff. I'm like, okay, like I, you know, just for the listeners out there, based kind of like the opposite of woke, like you say what you think, you don't give any fucks, you know, And, but they're like, well, you know, I have like, you know, this like startup, I have this, that, you know, I'm just like, you know, when the time will come. And, you know, people have been saying this to me for 20 years because I've been a loudmouth for 20 years. And I'm going to tell you, most of you are pussies. You're never going to actually, you're never going to actually like reach the stage of comfort and security where you're going to stick your neck out. That's not how you're built. Most people are conformists. They are cowards. The goal has to be to push that small margin and just increase it a little bit. And, you know, it's not always easy. You know, Steve and I put ourselves out there. People come after us. You know, like I get like social media mobs probably about every 6 to 8 months, although it's kind of calmed down recently. I don't know. I think people are just getting, probably because academic Twitter has kind of died, you know?
Here's just a brief comment because I know we're running out of time. Academics do value argument and intellect and, they claim that they decide their beliefs rationally, but I've never, ever had a wokester academic come at me on the facts. It's never happened. It's never happened. So they say like, well, I didn't like what you wrote in this blog post. I'm like, let's talk about it. You think this paper published by these researchers at Harvard, do you think the paper's wrong? Tell me why you think it's wrong. Or did I misrepresent what I said about this paper in my blog post? Tell me which sentence do you disagree with? I've never, ever had on a campus where I was the top research person on this campus of over 2,000 professors. I knew people in the neuroscience department, the psychology department, the engineering department, you know, everything. I knew all of them. Not a single, this is for your listeners. This is about the academic integrity of professors and scientists in this country. I've never had anyone, even from this sociology department, come to me and say, hey, Steve, let's talk about what you're saying, because I think these are racist statements. You know, when you say that, IQ measured at age 13 is relatively predictive of like earnings at age 50, right? I think that's a racist statement. Let's talk about the data, why you think that's true, or whose study you're quoting when you reference that result. I've never had that happen. It's just absurd. Like within physics, if I make some tiny little statement about some theorem about, you know, the mass of a spin 1/2 quantum field, or, you know, guy will come to my office and we'll argue about it for 3 hours until one of us is convinced that the other guy's right. That's what really should happen in academia. On this particular thing, I've never, ever had a wokester come to me and have a serious scientific discussion over a point of disagreement. It just shows how little depth there is in that other position. And, you know, your friend Paige Harden, whoever it is, I'll debate them right now, you know, on a video, and we can talk about the science and we'll talk about where do I agree with you, where do I disagree with you. It will turn out that we'll probably agree on almost everything, and where we disagree, they may look like a fool. Okay. So that's what I have to say to these people.
Yeah. You know, we ended with harsh words to the world out there, but sometimes it's necessary. This is why Steve was you know, the knives came out for him. But I mean, this is reality. That's what we're trying to understand. That's what we're trying to get at, whatever domain it might be. I hope, you know, I feel like Steve and I can at least hold our heads high and be like, you know, we didn't misrepresent who we were to the world. For it to be safe. And I hope that you guys appreciated this conversation. I know that I got a little bit harsher than I usually do, but I feel strongly about this. I feel strongly about what happened to Steve. I feel strongly about what's happening to academia, and I feel strongly about the truth. And if you go against the truth, you go against me, and I'm going to commit you, you know? And I let myself go a little. I apologize for some of you. I'm usually a little bit more congenial and I avoid the harsh words, but sometimes the harsh words are the truth. And so that's why it came out.
Hey, Razib, I if you give me 2 minutes, I want to tell you a story I've never told before, just to illustrate.
Okay. Yeah. This is for your ears only, listener.
Yeah. I'm new in the job. It's one of the first years that I'm running this promotion and tenure process at Michigan State. About 150 professors go through this every year. And one of the cases was a promotion to tenure case. There's a thick file, all their research publications, student evaluations, and letters of evaluations from outside people in their field. Okay. And then letters from their dean and chair, all that. It's a very thick file that I have to read through. I'm in this room. I'm looking through I've already read the file where I'm meeting with the dean, and the associate deans and all the people from that college. And you know me, I give zero fucks, right? So I'm reading it and I said, this guy's record is weak. He doesn't have any he's not the main PI of any big grant. His publications are pretty weak. I don't understand why you guys are saying this is a strong case. Okay. I'm just totally flat out. This is how it works. Almost nobody in the world knows how this works. If you're not, even the professors don't know how this works because you're only if you're a senior administrator, would you ever be in a meeting like this? Okay. So I'm going through the file. I'm saying this to the dean. I'm saying like, this is really not a strong case. I don't understand why you guys are writing about it as if it's a strong case. So I'm just asking for clarity, right? And what am I missing? Did I miss some major award he got or some big breakthrough that he made that did I misread the file? There's extreme discomfort among the people from that college. Okay. The dean is uncomfortable. The associate dean is uncomfortable. Everybody's like, kind of like, well, why is Steve pressing this matter? Doesn't he understand? And I'm like, what are you talking? So I'm like totally confused. And the guy had what I thought was either a German or Jewish surname. Okay. And I'm totally colorblind, ethnicity blind, whatever. I was just judging the file the way I judged it. But the guy's name was a kind of German / perhaps Jewish last name. And they were just going around and around, just telling me why he's a nice guy. He's really important to the department, to the college. I'm like, what the fuck are you guys talking about? Finally, I opened my laptop. I avoided looking at the people. I want to judge by the file. Okay. I open it up. Turns out the guy is black. Okay. But he had a name that probably what he was adopted, which didn't signal that at all. And I didn't look at the fucking color of his skin. I looked at his file. So then then I realized what these guys are saying to me. Like they were like, ha ha, surely you're joking, Mr. Feynman. You're not going to deny tenure to a black person, are you? Like, sure. I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with this system? Like, was I supposed to know he was black? It doesn't say he's black anywhere in the file. Was I supposed to like do a skin color test of all the people whose files I'm reading? That's the system I landed in. That's the system that runs your higher education in your country. I just want everybody to know that.
Well, on that note, which is a real note, I have heard not in those details as an administrator, but that's happened so much. Immigrants from other countries, they sometimes do not understand the difference between text and subtext. And so, like, you know, they will think that minority means minority, but it means a very specific type of minority, you know? And so it's like they get really confused and they have to like be pulled aside and like, you know, whispered conversations and they're like, okay, you know? Yeah, so it's like
there are many hundreds of like, say, Chinese faculty at Michigan State University, and they among themselves, they may be telling some newcomer, hey, by the way, you're going to be judged much more harshly than some other people in your cohort because
yeah.
You know, like, oh, if we have to keep some Chinese guy in our department who speaks broken English, that guy better be a fucking superstar in his research.
Dime a dozen.
Literally the mentality that people have in this country. So it is what it is.
Yeah. Well, with that, you know, I'll link to your blog and everything like that. Steve, it was great talking to you. Great catching up. I'm sure we'll see each other IRL soon. I'll let you go to your next meeting. And I got another meeting as well. We're busy guys. And like, if you guys got problems with us, come at us. We'll talk.
Yep.
Amen. All right. Later, Mo.
Whole genome sequencing is used for adults and children every day to assess risk for thousands of diseases. Orchid, a genetics company led by scientists from Stanford, is able to do this for IVF embryos. Now, instead of waiting for a diagnosis, parents can assess if their embryos have genetic variants known to cause severe conditions before their child's even born. No other tests can detect these issues so thoroughly or so early. So check them out at orchidhealth.com.
This podcast for kids. This